welcome to the show. It's great to have you with us. Time to talk Africa. And this week on the show, we're looking at justice and inclusion. We have a great panel with us. We get your views on the issues, and we have Africa's top 10. You're watching the Africa Leadership Dialogues. I'm Julie Gichuru. This week on the show, we look at the issues of justice and inclusion, critical issues. Our panel, we have with us Abdul Noormohamed, a human rights lawyer and activist currently working with the Open Society Initiative of Eastern Africa. He's working towards building capacities of individuals and local NGOs to promote human rights and justice issues. Samia Omar is a social development expert and co-founder of Friends of the Lake Turkana and Save Lamu. She's worked with marginalized communities in Lamu, Marsabit, Turkana counties as well, and in many other capacities. Benedict Wachira is a student, a socialist, a Pan-Africanist, and a budding politician. He's the Secretary General of the Social Democratic Party. Welcome to the show. Benedict, I know you'll say I'm not budding. I am a politician. We'll go into all that in just a short while. But the first question I want to ask around issues of justice is a very philosophical question. Lady and gentlemen, whose justice? Let me start with you, Abdul.
Well, the concept of justice, Julie, as we normally say, is that it means different things to different people. Is it moral justice or ethical justice, legal justice, or religious justice? So different communities perceive justice from their own perspective. So communities feel that maybe we want justice because historically certain things were not done to us and they need to be done now. Yet lawyers will want to see justice from position of the law in which they don't go back into history. So the problem we might have as a society or in Kenya is that different people perceive and interpret the same word justice differently.
Yeah. And that's powerful. Samia, coming from your work with marginalized communities in particular, you know, how do they perceive issues of justice and how do those in power perceive them and how do we find a common understanding?
I think to reiterate what my fellow panelists is, the marginalized communities themselves have a very unique definition of justice. And I think depending on whether they're using divine law or whether they're using their cultural traditions or they're using secular law, the marginalized community can feel either disenfranchised by the existing law that's actually on paper.
Right.
So while a majority of the public follows the law that's on paper to follow justice, that law was developed by the same people who are not the marginalized community. So when you put it in that sense, there will always be disenfranchisement if the law in itself does not consider the different definitions that these communities have. And I look at most lawyers and most judges, they do not come from the fringes of society, majority of them. And going, whether it's by definition of geography or by definition of ethnicity or even class. So what you see happens is a perpetuation of injustice by the existence of the law itself.
Right. And to paraphrase Martin Luther King Jr., how do you then follow a law that is in itself an unjust law?
Mm-hmm.
Benedict, you're a student, but you're also a politician.
Yes.
How do you perceive issues of justice, especially as a young man in Africa?
Well, for me, justice, when I look at justice, I also see what it tries to solve. Because when we speak of justice, it means that before that, we had oppression and exploitation. So my view of justice is first, we must deal with the source, the principal things that it tries to solve, and that is exploitation of man by man and oppression of person by person. I also see justice not in the classical sense of it, but also in the modern context that we are in. Things like social justice, where we have people who have been impoverished for a long time, and by themselves, because of the conditions that are there, cannot move themselves out of that impoverishment. So there's need for things like social justice. There is the idea that of workers' justice, where people go to work, raking millions for the farm or the factory where they are working, yet the returns that they get is too little. So there's also that aspect of justice, rather than the classical justice of just, you know, the courts, the lawyers, and all that.
You know, it's interesting, everything that comes up around justice. And you've talked about justice looking at the issues that it tries to resolve. But there's also the sense of justice as a state of being. You know, a foundational structure that you know, that demands some kind of common understanding, common value system. Does this exist, Abdul, a common understanding?
It can. And I was going to tell Benedict, actually, classical justice mm-hmm. is exactly what he described. The Platonian description is justice is the absence of injustice. And it's the legal justice where we have the problem, the legal justice. But society has always known justice to be where there's an injustice, where there's lack of injustice. So even when societies began forming as societies and living communally, they could tell when an injustice happened. It was inherently human for us to know that this is wrong. So even before religion, we could inherently know right from wrong. We could know that when a person doesn't have food, we need to give them food. Mm-hmm. When a person doesn't have a house, we need to give them one, to give them shelter. So societies have always known what justice was. It's only now when we began bigger societies, when different communities, different ethnic groups started living together in a larger group, is when we had different ideas of what that justice is and how we need to actualize it. So we do know right from wrong. It is intrinsic in every human. So it does exist. But how do we then make laws that then exemplify that justice?
Let's continue this conversation of intrinsic understanding of what is right and what is wrong. And I want to go to some of the cultural aspects that we have that perhaps are more abhorrent. And, you know, I openly want to, you know, speak of, for instance, cultures where cattle rustling is practiced, it's a common practice, and to compensate for death of a woman or a man or a child, you give different things, like perhaps a chicken for a child, a few camels for a woman or a man. You know, how do we start to ensure that our cultural practices actually fall in line with the common understanding, the common human understanding of what justice is and the value of human life?
I think every human being is born to understand that. When you look at a young child, before they recognize identity of themselves, there's actually, in psychology, there's a certain age where a child finally understands that this is mine and this is yours. And the moment that changes is when it's now a development of selfishness or a development of selflessness, whether I choose to share or I choose not to share. And so in order to change this, that the critical age in which to change a human being is at that young,
the formative years,
where simple things like learning to share with your neighbors or learning to share with the fellow classmates, it starts from a young age. Mm-hmm. And this should be from the teachers, from the parents, and from the public. But you see, we've come to a day where the public is no longer your teacher. Where when you see a child in the streets doing something wrong, it's actually now looked down upon if you actually correct the child. Then the parent comes and calls upon you and tells you to stop questioning their child, because it's my child, I know how to raise my own child. There's the African saying where a child is raised by a village, a child is not raised by parents. Mm-hmm. And so we need to remember, as Africans, look back at that saying and remember what our forefathers used to say, that you raise a child as a village.
So if the formative years are critical and you need to raise a child as a village, as a community, how do we retrain the adults who need retraining? And even around things like female genital mutilation, mm-hmm. you know, all these issues.
I think change doesn't come in one day. Mm-hmm. It takes time. And a generation, when you define a generation, whether some people define generation by 10 years, some people define generation by 25 years. So we can't say there's a solution that today we'll wake up and all of a sudden everybody will be fair and just. It takes time. Mm-hmm. And a starting point will be today. You could attempt to teach an old dog new tricks, but it'll be much harder than to actually be patient and persevere and with hope, the next generation will
allow evolution to do its work, you're saying, in a sense. Mm.
Well, help evolution do its work.
Help evolution. Okay. Benedict, let me come to you. Let's move from culture, though,
yes.
and move to power structures and governance now. How do we ensure the people that we elect and those who are put in positions of power understand the concept of justice?
First, I think justice is perceived, might be perceived in two different ways. There's the way the person who is in power or the person who oppresses or the cat rustler perceives justice, which is different from how mm-hmm. the victim perceives it.
Justice from whose perspective?
And the best perspective will be that of the victim. Because that is where you'll get the real... Because if it's cat rustling, as you had said, and we come here, we steal your goods, we kill you, then we repay your family, you know, with two or three camels. These other people might think that, you know, they've done justice. They've given you three camels. But how is your family feeling? The three camels are worth nothing. So our perception of justice should be from the eyes of the person who's the injustice is done.
Stay with the Africa Leadership Dialogues.
In Zimbabwe, when Robert Mugabe reclaimed the land from the white farmers, he said, listen, we had an agreement with the UK. They've done us an injustice because they've gone back on that agreement. And as a result, we're going to do this. The white farmers who were there farming the land will say, hold on a minute, I have nothing to do with this. This is an injustice to me. In many of the land issues across many of our countries, this is the prevailing problem, that everybody has a perspective. And if you really listen to the stories, everybody has a victim mentality. So where then does justice come in, and who creates that common ground for understanding and for development and growth around areas of justice? Please, let's take some views from the audience on this.
The problem is we are not giving people platforms and opportunity to speak out. So when you don't give people opportunity and platform to speak out, the feeling in them will one day explode. There is a time we were doing some community dialogues in Korogosho and in Mathare, and we realized, even coming from the post-election violence, many people have not been given opportunity to speak out the hard feelings that they have. So by creating those platforms and people debating and discussing what problems were there, why did we fight in the first place? So it eases them, it gives them an opportunity to relive and then be calm again and make friends and start living as a family. So if we create platforms for these discussions, yes, this is your land as a Maasai land, but then what do we do now that we are here? We will get solutions, but in the event that we say we bury our heads in the sand and then say this problem started a long time ago and then there is no way we can go back, those feelings are still in those people. So unless we create those platforms as a nation, we give these people opportunity to speak it out, then we'll find solution. But without doing that, then the problem will not end.
Thank you, so powerful.
First is the scarcity of opportunity, majorly amongst us youth. I'm afraid it's reaching a time where youth are now going to start forming militia groups And this mainly to try and counteract why they are not being given these opportunities, because they feel abandoned, they feel neglected by society, betrayed by the political class, and mostly they feel like they are criminalized by the police. Anything happens, they're the first people that will be run to. They're the first people who are the first suspects. So majorly, these are some of the issues that first need to be addressed. And this mainly is with context to social justice.
We cannot standardize justice because each case has its own kind of identity in itself. But what we can do is not have the sense when we're asking who's right, who's wrong. There needs to be a sense of, okay, there needs to be a sense of decorum in the sense that there should not be one person deciding justice. Mm. It should not be one person, and it needs to be justice for everyone in the sense that, like I said, do not ask who's justice. Everyone's justice.
The reason as why we talk about historical justices or historical injustice, it's not so that we can go back to the original position. It's because we can see how they came up and how we can prevent them in the future, and also how we can have a future that is rid of this, that is, this injustice is not there. For instance, the land question, which comes up, you know, every time when we're discussing historical injustice. We cannot go back and say that now here is where the Kikuyus used to live or the Maasai's, because eventually we might all leave Kenya and go back to Sudan and Ethiopia and Central Africa.
And South Africa.
Yes. What we need to do is, for instance, we say land is our common resource. Let us come together, plan it, so that we say this is where people will live, this is where people will farm, this is where we'll build our factories and everything else. And then once we plan like that, nobody will feel disenfranchised, because everybody has a house, you are eating, if you're a farmer, you have, you know, somewhere where you can do that. And it will also solve a lot of problems, not just in Kenya, but also across Africa.
So this stems from leadership, good leadership.
Yes.
Thank you. Samia, your thoughts?
I think before giving my thoughts, I'd like to maybe not necessarily disagree with Benedict, but earlier when he had said that you take the perspective of the victim, because who, like you, we're all asking, who is the victim? And everybody thinks they are the victim. So what we need to first qualify is what, how do you define a victim? Do you victimize one person for the benefit of all to get justice? Do you allow for one person to be victimized so that everybody can get justice? Or do you look for justice for that person, but then cause conflict and division amongst
for others,
for a whole country or a whole region or even the universe? And so when we look at it in that way, you can't really go back and track history and say, well, we'll go back all the way to Christopher Columbus in order to get justice for the people of United States. If we started to do that, then it will bring back to question us here today. Should we go back to the Garden of Eden? Not even, I don't even think we can track back how far we can go. So I think the first step is, how do we define a victim? Is it somebody who has been committed an injustice? Or is it somebody who is totally innocent and has never, ever committed an injustice? I don't know if, Jesus said, he who has no sin cast the first stone. Mm. So if we put it in that sense, then none of us can actually be a victim. If we take the all the negativities that our forefathers. So I think the first step as a country and as a region is, let's set up the first structures to say never again. Mm. We're never going back in history. We're never repeating 2007. We're never repeating colonialism. The moment we say that and we apologize publicly and say, as a people, if I am an Arab, I say, I acknowledge slavery happened, and we apologize, and it will never happen again. If I am a British, you say, well, we acknowledge colonialism happened, and it will never happen again. And I think that's what people want to hear. And the moment you hear that, even a rape victim can accept it's easier to accept.
You start to heal.
You start to heal. That is the process.
Yeah. Powerful, powerful thoughts. Abdul, let me come to you. Is that why we call, and justice is referred to as a she. Is that why she has scales and we call them the scales of justice? Is yes, she weighing things?
It's also why she's blind. Yes.
She's blind.
She's also blind. She's not supposed to see them. She's simply supposed to balance it and find good between what is right and what is wrong. Mm. But in addition to this, when we keep looking, the reason why we have to look back is not because we want to dwell on it, but we need to acknowledge it. And acknowledgement of the past is so important because it informs the policies of the present, which is why, for example, we can't tell the African-American people not to keep talking about slavery, because it is important to acknowledge that. It is important for the Jewish people to acknowledge the Holocaust. It is important for the Aboriginal people to acknowledge what happened for them. So acknowledging the past informs the policies of the present, but we can't keep dwelling that this happened. But because it happened, it informs the present, and we need to have these different truths of the past coexisting so that no truth is more important than the other truth. So, and this is the different justice system coexisting, and this informs the present. So here we are now. We are nations of different ethnic groups. The past happened. We are now one nation. We need to move forward. And these are the solutions.
So powerful. Please, if you would each look into the camera, and we'll start with you, Benedict, on that side. Having had this discussion on justice, what message do you have for the African leadership and the citizenry? Please, directly.
Well, for the African leadership, what I can say is that they need to solve this problem since we gave them the mandate. And if they cannot solve them, then they should just, you know, resign, walk out, and we have other people who have ideas on how to solve these problems. Otherwise, they have no business being there if we continue having the same injustices, the same complaints over and over again. To the African citizenry, what I'd like to tell them is that they should raise up their consciousness, rise above this petty ethnic, racial, nationalist ideals which divide people, and come and unite so that they ensure that nobody is oppressed, nobody is exploited, either by them or by the leaders or by another class or whichever divisions that we have.
My message is for the African leadership to recognize it's not their law and it's not their power. It's our power and our law. And to come down to the people that they serve and find out what they can do for the people. Dialogue, and remember before you are a leader, remember a time before when you were a child and playing games with the same people who you are now governing over. I think the moment you take that back, you might realize that it's not about the leadership you have today. It's about the leadership that you will leave for your children or your grandchildren tomorrow. I think that is my simple message to the leaders of Africa.
I think the most important thing for African leaders is to reach out within themselves and transcend beyond themselves and realize that their truth is not the only truth, and that the other people, the people in opposition, the other people's in society's truth, they have to take them in because they are everyone's leaders. And legacy that you leave behind is more important than is the real strength. And it comes from within you. That is what you'll be remembered by, reaching out. To quote the American president, it's what people, when you unclench your fist, you'll find there are more people who are willing to shake it. And that is not a weakness, it is your strength.
Stay with the Africa Leadership Dialogues.
This week we asked you, how can African states best achieve social justice and inclusion? William Radido says, responsibility denotes the ability to respond to the situation. With responsible leaders and citizenry, social justice shall be achieved with equality response to the law, and laws delegated should be standard to the African continent.
Hi, my name is Angela Oyemo, watching the African Leadership Dialogues from Nairobi. African states can best achieve social justice and inclusion by opening up borders to encourage trade and heavily investing in infrastructure. Thank you.
To join our conversation, go to our G+ page, Africa Leadership Dialogues, on Facebook, Africa Leadership Dialogues, on Twitter, @AfricaLD, and on WhatsApp, send your video comments to +254 715 816 033.
Remember, you can keep this conversation going, of course, on our platforms on social media, but also www.samosafestival.com. They're discussing these issues over the next few weeks. You can get in touch with them on the website, perhaps attend the functions that will be ongoing, and make your views known on the issues. Time now for Africa's Top 10.
On our top 10 this week, we feature ways in which Africa should promote social justice and inclusion. Starting us off at number 10 is formulating social inclusion policies. These policies should be accessible, financially sustainable, adaptable, and efficient. Coming in at number 9 is capacity building in institutions. Africa should put in place socio-political and economic capabilities and endowments. Sustained investment in people and institutions will transform Africa. Taking the number 8 spot is citizen participation. Incorporating citizens in the design, implementation, and monitoring of the policies will go a long way in ensuring they grasp the relative importance of these policies and strive to make them successful in their surroundings. At number 7 is enhancing access to knowledge and information. This will enable citizens to understand and accord respect to the culture of other societies. Knowledge will help instill the value of respect and appreciation of diversity. Slotted in at number 6 is a creation of an open space for dialogue to explore policy options. The idea behind the open space for dialogues is to ensure all citizens have a voice and their views are taken into consideration. Embracing cultural diversity takes the number 5 spot. The African continent is made up of diverse cultures that celebrate multiple and diverse expressions of identities. This diversity of opinions provides checks and balances crucial for the development of society. Coming in at number 4 is positive narratives of an inclusive society. Potent narratives can act like a magnet, drawing society towards an envisioned future. Societies that maintain a unity of purpose or a shared vision and encourage broad-based stakeholder participation in the formulation of that goal will be more inclusive. Taking the number 3 spot is investing in social capital. By doing so, African governments will be utilizing the components of social capital, which are optimism, voluntarism, and trust to foster good relations and acceptance within our societies. This will ensure no one is left out as others surge forward. Positioned at number 2 is existence of a strong civil society. Civil society can help the community by playing a crucial role in ensuring that people are able to accept each other, no matter the race, religion, gender, and political affiliations. And our number 1 this week is addressing discriminatory laws and practices. Discrimination takes many different forms. Eliminating or amending discriminatory laws and addressing discriminatory practices are fundamental in laying down the foundations of an inclusive society. And that's Africa's Top 10 this week.
It's time to close the show now, and our proverb is on food. We've had quite a few of these. Another interesting one. And it goes: a bad cook also has his or her share of the bad food. We want to enjoy our meals, so let's put the effort into cooking them properly. Blessings to you, and blessings to Africa.